How does a bike that hasn't been produced or updated for over a decade maintain such a fanatic following? We'll get to the bottom of that in this video. Frickin' Jim here, and this is an in-depth review of the late model Honda XR250R. The 1996 through 2004 XR250R is an air-cooled 249cc carburetor-fed dry-sump 4-stroke single with a 6-speed transmission and cartridge-damped suspension. Honda intended it to be the lightest, most economical, and most beginner-friendly of their full-size XR bikes. As I'll explain in this review, the bike accomplishes these goals quite well. I've owned one of these interesting and fun bikes for ages and have put countless miles on it. Now that my 1998 bike is almost 2 decades old, it's finally time to give it a thorough review. This review will discuss and demonstrate a variety of topics, including ergonomics and comfort, suspension, brakes and handling, load bearing and passenger carrying, electronics and lighting, engine, transmission, and fuel efficiency, reliability and maintenance, upgradability, and I'll wrap up with the final opinion I've come to after owning the bike for much of my life. Ergonomics and comfort. The level of comfort that the XR offers is something you will never find on a modern dirt bike. Most bikes now are made to be ridden standing on the foot pegs with only short breaks of sitting added in during cornering. That means the foot peg to handlebar distances are spread out to accommodate a rider that is standing, hunched in the attack position while riding, and the seats are thin pieces of mediocre padding that provide no comfort. The old XR takes a different approach. It was designed with both standing and sitting in mind. The foot peg to handlebar relationship is not aggressively skewed towards standing riding. Instead, it's a compromise between being set up for riding while standing and riding while sitting. However, it's a compromise that more accurately reflects the actual amount of standing and sitting that people on long, maybe semi-aggressive off-road rides will actually do. The seat on the XR is actually a true saddle, wide enough and with enough padding so that it is actually comfortable. In my experience, the original seat on this bike is actually more comfortable than most aftermarket seats for other bikes. Now, of course, the seat doesn't allow you to really sit up on the fuel tank to grab aggressive front-end traction like modern bikes do. Oddly enough, because of the geometry of the frame and suspension, which I will discuss later, getting up on the tank is really just not all that necessary on this bike. The clutch pull is very easy when maintained properly and can be controlled all day with one finger. However, if the cable is never cleaned or the lifter linkage is never lubricated, it will eventually seize up and the cable will be at risk of snapping. The brake controls for both the front and the rear brakes are engagement point adjustable, just like on most hydraulic dirt bike brakes. Overall, this is a very comfortable bike. That is simply not something you will hear someone say about a modern dirt bike. It simply doesn't happen anymore, which is just one reason why this bike is so special. Suspension, brakes, and handling. The XR is no motocross bike. It will not perform well in environments where there is lots of jumping or other types of huge G-outs applied to the suspension. Instead, the combination of relaxed suspension action and forgiving frame flex provide a very enjoyable ride under the conditions found in typical trail riding and desert wandering. While modern bikes are being designed to allow maximum control when ridden ultra aggressively, the XR again takes a different approach. The XR is of course very comfortable and compliant when being ridden in a relaxed manner. But the most interesting thing happens when you attempt to ride the XR aggressively. On modern bikes, I've learned that the more you wrangle and wrestle the bike, the faster it will take you. The XR is almost the complete opposite. When you try to ride the XR aggressively like a modern bike, it will punish you and put you on the ground quickly. Instead, to get the XR going really fast, you kind of have to let it do its own thing. You just have to loosen up, roll on the throttle, and let it work its magic. I've found that when I do this, the XR will just sort of plow through everything like a tank. This makes it really good for blasting through the desert at high speeds. You just have to get it up to speed and let it do the rest. I always find myself laughing when applying this method because it pretty much just doesn't make sense. It just works, and I can't complain about it. On top of this, the XR has what seems like an impossible combination of high-speed stability and low-speed maneuverability. Again, another thing about the XR that just doesn't make sense, but it just works. This combination makes the XR an absolute weapon in the desert. It has the stability to blast 80 miles per hour in the open, but when the trail tightens up to single track, it is ready to corner hard and flow through the turns like no other. Like I said before, to get this bike maneuvering quickly, you somehow don't even need to get up on the tank. It is just strangely well balanced on its own. And once again, you just have to let it do its own thing. I just don't get it, but I love it. The actual suspension on this bike is relatively low tech, but actually offers a decent level of adjustability. The front forks are 41mm KYB cartridge forks with 10.5 inches of travel, as well as externally adjustable low-speed compression damping. Aside from the low-speed compression damping, all other adjustments can only be made internally. Adjustments to the overall fork damping can be made by switching to different viscosity suspension fluid. High-speed compression damping can be adjusted by adding or removing shims on the base valve of the forks. Rebound damping can be adjusted by adding or removing shims on the damper rod valve of the forks. The air spring effect, which controls the majority of the bottoming resistance in the forks, can be adjusted by using more or less suspension fluid in the forks. The rear shock is also a KYB unit. It features an attached reservoir, externally adjustable compression damping, externally adjustable rebound damping, spring preload adjustability, and allows for 10.5 inches of travel. The external damping adjustments offer the widest range of adjustment I've yet to see on an OEM shock. On my XR, both the compression damping and rebound damping can be taken from literally rock hard to basically no damping, with only the use of the external damping adjustment clickers. OEM suspension units generally don't allow this wide range of adjustment because people could get themselves killed by messing things up. But for some reason, Honda allowed it on this one bike. The internal shim stacks can also be modified to provide different damping curves. Overall, I've been happy enough with the suspension, and I haven't needed to upgrade it beyond simple tuning. Eventually, when I do a build series with this bike, I will be upgrading the suspension. But for ages, I have just left it as is, and it has been good enough to provide countless hours and miles of fun riding. I've found the brakes on this machine to be excellent. Both the front and rear are Nissan hydraulic disc brakes. The front has a dual piston caliper, and the rear is a single piston caliper. Both provide the right amount of control and stopping power in the dirt when kept in good condition. I've simply never had a problem with these brakes, other than one bent rotor, which was very easily replaced. Overall, the handling on this bike works well enough for what I do with it, which is ride all sorts of trails. It's just an easy to ride, light, and fun handling machine. Load bearing and passenger carrying. Oddly enough for a dirt bike, it almost seems like the XR was designed with a bit of load bearing in mind. The subframe extends pretty far back and is fairly beefy for a dirt bike. There are racks available which take advantage of the subframe, but I've been happy enough with using a Giant Loop Mojave saddlebag system and Green Chili Adventure Gear soft rack when I actually want to carry stuff with the bike. It is certainly possible to carry quite a lot of gear on this bike. For minimalist trail exploring, it is definitely possible to add a small repair kit under the seat on the top of the airbox. But I've used this extra space to attach a battery since my XR is a dual sport conversion. With the under seat space taken up, I simply keep my repair kit in a cheap front fender pouch, which I've found to be very reliable and unobtrusive. I've taken passengers on this bike a couple of times just by adding these cheap passenger pegs, but this is definitely not the first bike in my garage that I would choose for two-up riding. Electronics and lighting. The XR comes stock with a simple AC lighting system, which powers a headlight and a tail light. There is no battery, light switches, or other electronics. It is just a bare-bones running light system intended to keep the bike visible in dusty or low-light conditions. The stock headlight is not good enough to do any serious night riding. Upgrading to a higher wattage headlight bulb doesn't do much good either, since the original system just doesn't have enough power to really make use of a bulb with more draw. Luckily, there are easy and inexpensive ways to convert the bike's lighting circuit to DC, which then allows for much better lighting and the ability to add whatever electronics you want. This can be accomplished by either wiring the AC power to an off-the-shelf rectifier or by upgrading to an aftermarket stator and using the accompanying regulator rectifier that comes with it. Using the cheap off-the-shelf rectifier method, I've been able to add lighting to my XR which is adequate for moderate night riding while maintaining the stock stator. I've found that LED and HID lights are the best to run when using the stock stator. Engine, transmission, and fuel efficiency. The engine is a 4-stroke, air-cooled, 249cc, over-square, single overhead cam, radial 4-valve single, with a dry sump oil system and a 30mm carburetor, mated to a 6-speed transmission. What all this translates to is basically one of the most unique engines ever found in a dirt bike. The combination of an over-square short stroke ratio, 4 radially aligned valves feeding a hemispherical combustion chamber, and the light rotating mass of a single overhead cam all come together to make a quick revving and free revving engine with plenty of potential. In bone stock form, the engine lacks the off-idle low RPM torque that most people expect from an air-cooled single, but the healthy mid-range power makes up for it. However, with just a couple of cheap modifications, which I'll discuss in the upgrade section of this video, the bike can be transformed to have excellent low RPM torque and exhilarating all-around power. Absolute acceleration will of course depend on lots of variables, including rider skill, weight, riding elevation, and final drive ratio. But to give you an idea of what kind of acceleration to expect, I went out to record some numbers. Measuring several 0 to 60 mile per hour runs on my XR at 3,000 feet elevation, I achieved a fastest 0 to 60 mile per hour time of 6.97 seconds. Compare that to a couple other bikes that are currently produced in what used to be the XR250R's price range, and we can see that it is really not slow. The 2013 KLX 250S is over a second slower at 8.4 seconds. Same with the CRF 250L at 8.6 seconds. The XR would run circles around an XT250 at 10.5 seconds, but it wouldn't quite keep up in a straight line with the WR250R at 6.7 seconds or the DRZ400S at 6.3 seconds. The highest speed that I've been able to eke out of my XR was 85 miles per hour on a highway, though these kinds of numbers don't matter very much on this type of bike. What really matters is how usable and broad the power is in the dirt, and the XR really does well in that aspect. The dry sump lubrication system on the bike uses the frame's front down tube as an oil reservoir. This system allows a large oil capacity without having extra dead space in the crankcases. It also puts the frame to work as an oil cooler, so the whole system works out well to prevent all sorts of oil-related issues that happen on wet sump engines where the oil is solely stored in the crankcases. I should also note that the engine on this thing is somewhat noisy due to the sub-rocker system used to actuate the radially configured valves, which all point in a different direction. This valve configuration requires what Honda has called a sub-rocker arm for each valve. Most single overhead cam engines only have 2 rockers total, but this engine has a total of 8 rockers and 4 cam loads, which can literally make the bike sound like a bucket of bolts sloshing around at times. The Kian PD round slide carburetor on this bike is probably the one thing that most people complain about, and I have to say that I agree with most people. Starting the bike when cold with the Kickstarter can sometimes take a strange ritual of applying the full choke, pulling in the decompression lever, giving the bike 10 kicks at wide open throttle, offering the bike its choice of fine European chocolate, then releasing the throttle and giving it one good full kick from a couple degrees past top dead center on the compression stroke. It sounds like a joke, but sometimes it's really the only way. The carburetor is also very flood happy, and after pretty much any drop, it takes another ritual to get it started again. You'd think that after owning the bike for so long, one would have the jetting dialed in, but the carburetor on my bike is so sensitive to every change in the atmosphere that I've just given up. Besides, I've become pretty good at the starting rituals. Most owners have reported that all starting and jetting issues go away completely with a switch to basically any other carburetor than the Kian PD that comes stock on the bike. The 6-speed transmission on this bike is probably the best kept secret in the dual sport and off-road world. With almost all other dirt bikes, People complain that they can't get enough overdrive out of Top Gear while maintaining usable gear ratios for low-speed technical riding. This is simply not an issue with the XR's 6-speed transmission and exceptional gear ratio spread. I have my bike geared to where it can maintain plenty of speed on open roads, yet first gear still remains a crawler gear. With this transmission, there is a gear for every situation, and it really helps out. The only downside to the transmission is that the original clutch springs are a bit weak for more aggressive riding, and this leads to the clutch burning out often on a modified engine. But this is very easily fixed by shimming the original springs or using heavy-duty Barnett springs. Fuel efficiency on this bike is exceptional for a dirt bike. Of course, off-road conditions vary wildly, so off-road fuel efficiency numbers are somewhat arbitrary, but I've seen everything from 40 miles per gallon to 65 miles per gallon off-road. On the road, fuel efficiency numbers that I've recorded have been between 50 and 80 miles per gallon. Still, a really wide spread. I used this bike as my main mode of transportation for about 2 years, and during that time, the most common figures that I recorded were between 55 and 65 miles per gallon. With the original fuel tank, which holds about 2.5 gallons, the bike is generally good to go for over 100 miles off-road, and that is what really counts on a dirt bike. Overall, the power plant offers plenty of get up and go for most types of off-road riding, and is certainly acceptable for on-road riding when needed. Reliability and maintenance. This is probably the biggest selling point of the XR, and the biggest reason for its cult following. It is just dang bulletproof and simple to maintain. On my bike, the regular maintenance is simply to change the oil and filter every once in a while, and clean the air filter at the same time. That's about it. Checking the oil level and performing oil changes can be a little bit tricky for people who are unfamiliar with the dry sump oiling system, because the oil must be warmed up and the bike must be idled for several minutes standing straight upright, not leaning too far on one side, to get an accurate oil level reading from the dipstick on the frame. I've seen countless forum posts about people saying they had to add several liters of oil to get a full reading on the dipstick, but it's just because they were all doing it wrong. Either not letting the bike idle for long enough, or leaning the bike over too far while idling is usually the problem. When I do it, I simply stand by the bike and hold it completely upright for 5 minutes, and that always gives me a good reading. On the other hand, the air filter is one of the simplest ever to perform maintenance on. The air box has a door on one side. By simply opening this door, the air filter can be accessed and removed. The only other maintenance is to replace the drive chain, sprockets, and tires as needed, and sometimes lubricate cables or grease the steering stem bearings and rear suspension linkage bearings when they start to feel a little clunky. The valve to rocker clearances may need adjustment on occasion, but they generally shouldn't. If they do require adjustment, it's not a good sign, because it means something is wearing down in the valve train. Luckily, when any kind of engine maintenance is required, it can virtually all be done without removing the engine from the frame. Honda made this bike ridiculously easy to work on, and anyone who ever has to dig into it will quickly come to appreciate that fact. In an ironic fashion, my XR always seems to have some new strange noise coming from it. Over the years, I've learned to simply ignore new noises. It's just not worth the worrying, because I've come to find that it just doesn't matter. There's going to be strange noises, I'm going to ignore them, and it's going to be just fine like it has been for years. Maybe the stubborn thing will give out someday, and if it ever does, I'll probably just celebrate, because it will mean that I can finally rebuild it with major upgrades. Upgradability. There is so much potential and support for upgrades on the XR250R that it is actually simple to discuss, because it can be rounded up by saying that with this bike, the sky is the limit. If you can imagine it, it has probably already been done to one of these bikes. The suspension can be swapped for modern suspension that comes on the latest race bikes. The engine can be turned into a 315cc, 40 plus horsepower monster, and the geometry and seating can be made into a modern configuration. Honestly though, I've had so much fun just enjoying the bike as it is that I haven't had much of an urge to upgrade it that far. I would recommend just a couple of simple and cost-effective upgrades. The uncorking mods, which involve removing the plug at the top of the airbox and drilling out the baffle at the exhaust, are basically free to perform. A big bore setup is around $200 US in parts, and when I had mine done, I was only charged $60 for the bore and hone on the single cylinder. Going to a 277cc big bore setup makes all the difference in the world, and at just under $300 in cost, it's something that should definitely be considered. Do-it-yourself internal suspension tuning can also work wonders, and Racetech's gold valve kits can make it even better and easier for a relatively low cost. If you'd like information on all of the modifications available for this bike, check out this website called XR250R Mods. I'll leave a link in the description of this video so that you can check it out at the end. Now for my final opinion. After owning this bike for a long time, the opinion that I've developed is that this is an excellent bike with huge potential that Honda never should have stopped developing. For me, the kickstarting is the one reason why it isn't my primary dirt bike. If Honda simply updated it to electric start, it would be 10 times more fun. Everything else about this bike is excellent for its intended purpose, and of course, it is just ridiculously reliable. I've been waiting for this thing to die for years, and it just won't happen. This is an absolute contrast to modern bikes, where people have to really be careful in order to not have the bike fail catastrophically. This bike is very practical, and if there are any for sale in your area, they can make a great investment or project bike.